Long before the first explorers discovered the waterways of Ontario, long before the first expeditions to the continent of North America were even dreamed of, Essex County, for centuries, had been inhabited by men. Since these people left no written records, the only means by which we can learn of their existence and of their culture is through archaeology. By excavating and examining the relics of the past, such as fossils, bones, tools, weapons, pottery, and other remains, the archaeologist tries to reconstruct the history and the lifestyle of early people.
Depending on whose glacial hypothesis you use, sets the stage for man's first entry into North America and to the provinces too. And there are a dozen different glacial hypotheses that say that the last advance of the glacier was maybe 100,000 years ago, something, and maybe 40,000 years ago, or another. But if you're going to be an educator, you can't give all of these varied hypotheses. You have to decide on one, right? So the commonly accepted one is the latest, the one that is the safest, say that the last glacial advance was maybe 40,000 years ago. And 40,000 years ago, there were men, humans, Homo sapiens, in the general area. There are some students that argue that they were there much earlier. For instance, the Shiguinda site from Manitoulin Islands, which produces very early stone tool types made of quartzite. The argument there is that these people were there before the glacier. Because the archaeologist on that dig, whose name is Lee, has proven that these early fire pits are lying underneath glacially deposited boulders. But this is an argument in the business. You have a certain school that argues for early entry, and a certain other group that wants to be saved and argues for late entry. But there's no question that man was fully developed then was Homo sapiens at that period of time. The cultural baggage was sparse. They were migrant types who subsisted or lived mainly by following large herd animals. In the old world, it was the woolly mammoth. Here it was namely the American mastodon, or the Canadian mastodon, I suppose, if we want to be a little more nationalistic about it. But the thing to remember is they were continually on the move, following these big beasts. And they didn't have a whole assembly of weapons. They didn't travel in large groups, and generally small family groups. And so the method of obtaining food was rather difficult. Armed only with spears, you couldn't attack the beast because you would lose. You had to use your wile. So what they would do, they would sort of herd the thing into one of the local peacocks. And these animals were browsing anyway. And surround them and keep them in one spot until they admired themselves or admired their feet in the bog and couldn't run at them. Then the trick was to keep the flashing trunk or the tusks from doing any damage. So they would go in with these long spears and pierce the height of the beast and where it would bleed slowly until it became weak, and then they would go in and dispatch it, in most cases, with a spear thrust into the atlas vertebrae or into the head, and butcher the animal in the spot. Now, being as it was so deeply admired in the marsh, anyway, you couldn't haul all the animal away, so they would take the choice of steaks along the back. In most cases, the head was removed, and the trunk was a delicacy, of course, and the front and so forth. And archaeologically, this is generally how you determine it, what we know as a kill site when you find a beast like this, because in, after careful excavation, you can see that the skull of the beast was carried quite a bit away from the original kill site, and it was broken open with stone hammers. You can see the marks of the butchering on the skull, and certain other bones are in other parts of the site. And if you're lucky enough to find the original kill spot or the remains of the marsh, what you generally find is nothing but the four legs, what we call insect or sticking up in the marsh. Now, as you all know, the mastodon was an elephant-like creature. It had a, therefore had an extremely tough skin, right? There's nothing tougher than elephant skin. So it took an ingenious stone weapon to pierce a tough hide like that. We generally think of a spear point or a dart point or an arrow point as something with notches in the side. You'll realize that if you had a wide-based point and a stick on it, you'd have difficulty pushing that in a thick hide, and you would never be able to withdraw it because of the notched element or the haft element. These people had devised a point and where they would use nothing but the most exotic or the best flint, because it had to be super sharp. It had to be very thin. And so, therefore, you couldn't thrust a spear in and leave it. The points were too precious. You had to develop a point that you could push in and out, push in and retrieve your blade. And they did this by an ingenious method. Rather than putting notches on the side or the corner of the point, they took channel flakes or long flakes out of the full length of the blade, so that when they put the stick on, the stick blended right in with the blade, what we call fluting. And this is the diagnostic mark, or the indicative mark of the paleolithic blade. And indeed, they found, we have them recorded from Amherstburg, King Chatham, and Wallaceburg, and Leamington, all of them. There is no question that these Paleolithic people were living and eating in the local area, in the Leamington area especially. Give you an idea, we have recorded the existence of the remains of three mastodon in the Leamington area alone. Tilbury recorded mastodon remains this year. Chatham, certainly. Young bull mastodon was excavated not too long ago. So, human types were here. Very, very early. Now, during the early period, there was climate changes too as the glacier retreated back again, so you get rather drastic climate changes here, which brings about an extinction of these lumbering elephant-like animals, which we know as Pleistocene fauna. And so these hunter types then still are carrying on basically the same way of life, but have to adapt to a new environment and hunt a lesser type beast, which would appear to be the caribou. which had migration routes across. And were a little more easy to procure than these large elephant-like creatures. And they were taken in this same old way by driving them through peat bog and butchering them when they became immobilized in the mire. We do have records locally of kill sites of caribou. They would also dig pits where there were no marsh and sort of drive them into a pit where they would break limbs and so forth and could be dispersed later. It's rather difficult, I realize, to see all this going on along 401, Highway 2 or 3 right now, because it almost looks like plains out there. The trees have all been cut down. But in the early period, the vegetation was quite different. Game trails, if you've ever been in untouched country, it's almost impenetrable. And if you want to herd animals, you just cut a trail for them and get them going on that trail, and they're going to be going with a pitfall on one side or the other. It's not a question of going on an extended thing like the drives they have here. They get the jackrabbits to go after a funnel or anything. It would be a very simple thing to do. But you can also see now a transition, not only in the way of life of these people, in the diet, but you can also see that they don't need this super sharp point anymore. They don't have to go to all this trouble of getting rare and exotic flints from long distances away. And they can use now more local, inferior flints, and they can haft them because they don't have to worry about the beast fighting back, you see. Don't have to bother with the flutes anymore. They can now put them on some simpler method by putting mosses in the side and tying them on there. And so you see a transition then, at least in the tool assemblage, into what we call the archaic period. It is primarily denoted by this change in subsistence, as we call it, and tool types. You get large points, yes, but they're inferior to the older ones. And the fluting disappears. Now, other things happen. When you were hunting one singular mastodon, you could do it with a small family unit. But when you're waiting for the one, or basically two times a year type thing, where you're hunting migratory animals, and all of a sudden they appear and are only there for 2 weeks, at the most, you need more social interaction. Everybody's got to cooperate, right? And so you get not only little families, but now everybody comes to the migrating area, and it's a cooperative hunt by different families. So you get, now we're getting social interaction and cooperation. Then what do you do after the migration? Your favorite food is over. You have to then supplement your diet on other things, and so you start, I suppose, in the early period, experimenting with smaller type of game, experimenting with plants and gathering techniques. And so towards the end of the archaic, you do end up with a group of people that are primarily hunters and gatherers, and rather than having their weaponry showing total dependence on one type animal, now it shows dependence on many other type animals. Because you're going to use a different type blade, for instance, if you're hunting caribou than you are if you're going to shoot ducks. And with people living together now and being dependent on each other, all of a sudden, or slowly, rather than all of a sudden, I should say, you see that there is some respect for the dead, rather than somebody getting killed on them in the hunt or something, and just leaving them there, tossing them in with the scraps, the remains of the animal, I see some respect for the deceased person. And eventually religion falls, and there seems to be some sort of belief in a life after death, because they prepare them for the death journey. They put their favorite tools with them, or whatever occupational objects they had with them, you know, find them buried in the grave. But anyway, just now see elements of unique people. People that are entirely different from the other types. The weapons are entirely different. The way of life is entirely different. Some people, now you find, prefer the highlands. Some people prefer the river valleys. Some people prefer the shoreline. Some people are living on nothing but clams for their diet. Other people won't eat the aquatic life. They want the meat, hard meat. Some of these migrant groups know are not in the habit of working in flint for the barrel planks and stone tools. They're working in copper, something like the Bronze Age in the old world. We're getting all sorts of what we know as cultures now. Almost like today, you know. We have the ethnic festivals going on, we have the Greeks and the Italians. And so this is what happens in the general area. There's just literally dozens of diverse groups that speak different languages, undoubtedly, dressed entirely different, have different social habits, different religions, different ways of life completely. And this is not brought out in the local text. You would think, you know, Indians are Indian. They have a vocabulary of about four words, Kimosabi, and so forth, and they all wore big feathered headdresses. But this is far from the truth. Some scholars, for instance, will claim in the 15th century there were more diverse languages spoke in North America than all the rest of the world combined. You will find literally thousands of different types of projectile points. And ideally, each one would represent a different cultural group. You get in the field of ceramics, which is another one of the artifacts that sort of resists time. Again, you have all different shapes and forms and styles of pottery. Each one, again, presumably representing a different cultural group. For instance, the Weiser site, which I did near Wallaceburg for the past few years, this type of pottery has never been recorded before. No element of whether it's the ingredients they put into the clay or the decoration on it, has been recorded. And this happens over and over again archaeologically. All right, now, when it started out as sort of in Paleolithic, it's sort of a tundra-like country with sparse vegetation, which finally, in the Archaic, you start getting your evergreens as we know them. Small trees, and these in turn are changed to the hardwoods, and as the hardwoods get taller than the coniferous trees, then the coniferous trees are are killed by the bite. So you get what's called terminal woodland. Or terminal forest. We have huge trees and very few branches in the lower areas, yeah, because it's all shaded. And this was our final stage, relative to chronology. And now, in the woodland period, you find the Aboriginal populace here sort of reaching a peak. You now have elaborate burial ceremonies. You have complex political connections. You have tradesmen traveling all over North America bringing exotic trade goods in both directions, bringing things from here and trading them there, bringing, for instance, local float copper from Isle Royal and so forth down to the Gulf Coast, trading them for conch shells, which they made into large drinking vessels, and trading them for exotic new type flints such as obsidian and so forth. And it's not uncommon to find conch shell locally. For instance, at the Weiser site, there were ladies, pins for the hair made out of conch shell. They're brought in from the coast. And you get all sorts of small shell beads from the ocean that they made into, strung on and used for beads. So you have these tremendous trade networks going on. And where burial practices first started out by simply burying somebody in the ground, now you get the diverse number of what we might call earth monuments. You get small tumuli erected over the dead, and then rocks placed on it, and a few simple burial tools. And you get in that, like the effigy mound or the serpent mound up around Peterborough, which is in the form of a reptile and reflected across the border again by literally thousands of these effigy mounds in the form of everything imaginable. Birds, snakes, monsters, people, everything. And indeed you get into, at the close of the woodland period, you get into, not too far from here, earth monuments that are true pyramids. In Wisconsin, for instance, you get true pyramids with the steps leading up to the summit. Similar to the things you not only have in Egypt, but you have in Mexico, only these are made of earth rather than stone and rock. And you get cults forming, like the death cults, and which are in many, many ways strikingly similar to phenomena that you find other places in the world, such as Egypt, where when a notable person dies, then there are retainer sacrifices sent on the death journey with him, and fantastic trade goods put in them so they can have furnishings in the new world when there's a corporal rebirth. And this appears to be the stage when the first or when our forefathers arrived here. It's known that they weren't the first. It's common knowledge now that the Vikings were here before them, and most conservative scholars now will grant that the Japanese were making regular voyages here about 2000 BC. So there's been an awful lot of influence going on here all the time. But at least it would appear that in the 1400s, all this diffusion or migration of diverse people had culminated in what almost be called civilization. Only one thing lacking, of course. You've been taught, you're in school at the three stages. You start out with some savagery, to barbarism, to civilization, which is another example of the miseducation that's going on. Of course, with the savages, they don't have anything much in barbarism. They've got agriculture, right? But no written language. And when you finally reach that great stage called civilization, we start downhill. Have a written language. Yet we continually think of the Aboriginal people here as savages. There's no way they can fit the description of savages. In the winter season, we have our festive season. In fact, everything we eat, we got from the local natives. Corn, beans, squash, you name it. And certainly, they were at least barbarians. They certainly had a well-developed agriculture, in corn alone 20 different varieties. Had all this knowledge we didn't have. As a matter of fact, our forefathers would never have made it if it hadn't been for the hospitality and goodwill and the knowledge of the local Indian population. The big argument is whether or not they were civilized. Well, I can argue that they were just as civilized as some of our other groups. If we get the old textbook out again and take the sample of the world's first written language, the Sumerian tablet, which is nothing but a piece of stone or clay with a bunch of little pictures on it. If they hold this up as a sample of true writing, we can take a section of the rocket or the Peterborough petroglyphs or pictographs from anywhere else in the vicinity and say, aren't these just as valid? Certainly nobody sat here and chipped away and scratched away at this stone just to doodle. There must have been an attempt to give a message. And this is the basis of writing. So as far as definition is concerned, I would argue that these people were civilized. Civilization, look what we've done for them, you know.